Okay, we're going to try on this tape to get Robert's wing put together here from the wood that he already said. You got all the wood there, huh?
Yep.
Okay, we're ready to start working on it. Step one, this wood has a little bit of a bow in it. So what we did is we marked the wood right in the middle, and we want to cut both pieces at a trailing edge at once. Measured in from both sides, and that'll mean that the little bit of bow that's left in there will go on a side toward the cap strips, and the straight side we want to go by the trailing edge. Now Robert had 48 inch wood, so of course one piece is going to do it without a joint. If you had 36 inch wood, you'd need the joint. Now I want the straight edge in the back, so lay the straight edge up against the back of the wing for now, and you can get a look at this. This is what typically happens. You see the bow in that? And what we did, we cut the straight edge for the trailing edge. That's step one. You can go up against the ruler to make sure it's square. Okay, these are the laser cut parts that we've been using. We're leaving out the middle ribs. You may as well, you can number these if you want. Just number them for your own reference. Now at this point in time, you would have a choice. If you want to use the rod method, you could just run a rod through here. Well, we're going to try to use the pin block method. That works so well on a nobler. And maybe John Brodak will come out with a little part that I've been trying to invent from, a little plastic block that the pin would sit in, and he could write Brodak on the same side of it. In fact, Kenny had that idea. You could make those little blocks, precision blocks, and sell them as an accessory item. Think about it, John. Anyway, number these out. Start from the middle. This will be 1, 2, 3. Work from the middle out. Two ribs are going to go in the middle. The thickness of the fuselage apart. Yeah. It's for your own reference. If you drop them on the floor. Right, step one, we have a 3/16 square piece. We're just pinning it right to the trailing edge. No glue at all yet. Cut a little piece out at this end. You got more up here in a wood pile. So it doesn't matter where the joint is. We're not concerned with the joint right now. Just pin it in place, and we want to make sure it's perfectly straight, level with the table before we go on any further. Just trim the extra piece off. Now we got a trailing edge. That's a piece of 3/32. It would have a joint in it if we were using 3/32 wood. I mean, if we were using 36, but one piece of 48 actually goes tip to tip. Okay, now make sure that's perfectly straight, and then run a glue seam on this side. Just run the glue from one end to the other, and don't glue it to the table.
What do you mean if it's straight?
Oh, look who just walked in. Ah! Yellow man! Oh, it looks good. Walk into the wall or break the rudder or something so we have a repair to do. Looks good. Macho, look, he's ruining our day here.
Just on the inside.
Yeah, run a glue seam here. Just go right down and press it down as you go. Try not to glue it to the table if you can.
There's another piece of wood underneath there. I don't want to glue that.
Go to a hobby shop and you buy quarter inch squares. That one's a pretzel. That one's a pretzel. I don't even have to look at it. This one's usable. You got some straight ones here? This one's not so good. Get the two straightest. Oh, yeah, this is a beauty. Okay, get the straightest ones you can, and then we'll just lay out the ribs.
Okay.
Okay.
These are the ones that I got.
Those are the two best? Okay, let's use them.
Look at them. There's three here.
Okay, we need four altogether. You want four that are usable.
This one is not straight, but it's usable.
Usable? Okay, let's get these four. And just line up each rib. This is just temporary. We know the spar is going to drop in. Just run one side for now. And just work your way right down the wing. You could put your little pieces, just notch it in. Now if you want to support that under the front of the rib, you know, each one will be further back in or whatever. And just go right down to the next rib. Now, of course, you could use the rod method. That's always, I'm trying to do this without a rod because a lot of entry-level people are not going to have access to a rod right at this point in their building career.
I got a rod. I should have brought it.
Well, I got rods here too, but the point is an average guy is not going to have that.
This will take a little
straight. Joe Adamusco will have it, you know what I mean? Wait a minute now. You want to get these perfectly straight. See, that's why I put the blue tape on. Keep this straight. If you put this in on an angle, then the spar isn't going to be nice and straight. Okay, line that up. Let Kenny eyeball it too. Just eyeball it from the front and the side at the same time.
Doesn't make any difference whether it looks crooked to you. The tape is straight.
Yeah. Yeah, the tape wins every time. Okay. And you could just go from one end of the table, go right down to the other one, and just tack them to the trailing edge for right now. Now that's going to mean that you're definitely going to have a trailing edge that's nice and straight, and you got all little blocks of wood, anything just to hold them up off the table. What's that?
This one get glued. Did you? Oh, so you glued it. Okay.
Yeah, I glued those in.
What are we doing with?
Now spread them apart, the thickness of the body, so they're on the edge of the body. You know you're going to have a half inch fuselage there, so just put them. That's why I put the red tape there. The red tape is half inch. Okay.
How come that looks crooked to me?
Tape is handy because it's a little easier to reference off. Because this stuff is laser cut, these things kind of pinch together. You almost don't need glue on them. You just pinch the spar right in place. Now you can get the spar on the other side too. The wing is still floating along here with a breeze. And try to get the joint right in the middle between the two ribs. All right, do the same thing up at the other side. Glue these two together, then it won't keep spreading out on you. And just walk your way out from the middle to each end. Put one drop of glue in there, just to hold the two of them together. Just walk it down. Don't put any glue on it yet till it's all lined up. They all snap together like little, those Lincoln logs. Make sure they're all straight. Kenny, sight it from the front.
These don't go into the spars. They have to go into the rib. They're not thick enough. Yeah.
That's just holding it up temporary. That's not going into to be part of what we're doing yet. Okay, you get one drop of CA on each one of these joints and just lay the top spar in place.
Make sure the curve, this is the top. Use that as the top.
Just drop it right in place. It should fit nice and tight.
Make the curve go down. What do you mean?
Let the curve go down, not up.
It's not straight. Curve goes down.
So we're going this way.
Yeah, but make sure it sits into all the little bays.
The top.
See, when you buy that wood, like at the hobby shop, look at all of them and only take the straight ones. Don't take any of the crooked ones. And just make sure each one is in all the way. Because this wing is still just sitting in midair right now. There's nothing attached to the table. We just want it tacked. Now all those little joints are nice and tight. Now just go from one end to the other, make sure each joint is tight, and put one drop of CA on it just to hold it in place. Permanent joint now. Glue the two together and just tack them. Everything is free floating still. The only purpose of having this is just to have it free floating, just so it isn't wiggling around in your hand. Now the front leading edge ones don't matter if they have a little bow in them. Let the bow face in. But those top ones should be kind of straight. With his own saw. Now you can lay out the two leading edge pieces and do the same thing. One drop of glue on each joint.
No.
He's got the quarter inch squares over there. And if you have a bow in them, let the bow face in at the wing.
Which way?
Now one of them's dead straight, one of them has a bow, so look at them.
See which one has the bow.
This one's bowed all.
Yeah, but who bought this wood? You. I mean, what are you going to blame Riley Wooten? What ninja bought this wood? Buy straight wood.
But when this is glued in, this one will straighten out. This one's not.
Yeah, let the curve go toward the middle. Start your joint at the middle, the same as we did by the spar.
Yeah, look at this one here. This one we could use anyway. It doesn't have to go either way.
Right. That one is perfect. Now just start in the middle. Yeah. Put one drop on each joint. Don't make a permanent joint. One drop. You just drop these parts in. Because you get such nice tight fits at the laser ribs, everything just locks right together like a little Lincoln log guy. Yeah, put the little, that'll be a help. Now that's the truth. This is the first built-up wing you ever made, Robert? I mean, the first, or did you make other ones?
Built-up wing?
Yeah.
I never got a straight one.
Okay.
Let's put it that way.
Well, that's what I'm trying. I'm trying to, you know.
Okay. No, just, you blew all spray.
Okay. Just work your way from one end to the other.
No, hold it for a second after you blew it.
Hold it till you feel it start to kick off.
Go ahead. It didn't. You move the.
Just one drop is enough to hold it. It's not a permanent joint yet. Because we still want to be able to massage this wing and get it. If it doesn't come out straight, we can tweak it back.
More than just a little. Which way are we going with this?
All right, now take the piece.
I put a pink mark where it goes in.
The pink mark goes in. All right, now everything is still nice and flexible. Check each joint that you're not above or below. One of these didn't jump out, even though that looks pretty good. And just zona saw these extra things off so we can get a good reference on it when we do the alignment. Okay, now that basically took, I would say, realistically, 10 minutes? How long did it take to do this much of it, Ken? 10, 15 minutes?
How much? 15 minutes.
15 minutes to get to this point. Okay, and just zona saw it right off. Okay, here's the deal now. We're going to have to do this with slow drying glue. So get all our pins ready. What I want to do now, I took all the pins out. I want to just put some 5-minute epoxy right down each one of these, lay the trailing edge piece right back on, pin it all together, and then let that dry. Then we'll have one solid trailing edge, and from that point on, then we'll put the pins in, lock it into position, and put permanent glue joints on everything. Let's mark that's how far up we're going to put the epoxy. I guess you could use slow CA, but if we had some. All right. Mix that up with a Q-tip and just lay it right on. See, the reason for doing this is you got plenty of time now to work on it. You got a full 5 minutes to get this laying down nice and straight. I'm afraid if you start doing this with CA, it's going to kick off in one spot and not the other. Basically, we could look right down the rod hole, so this can't be too bad. The 15-minute wing by Robert Sabatino. Reference off the trailing edge now. If you have to, let the trailing edge even stick out a little bit. Okay, start at his end, get one pin in each side. Nice and straight on the edge? Yeah, okay. Just go right down now, your glue is starting to kick off.
Yeah,
go right down.
We gotta roll.
Just keep putting one pin in. If we have any extras, just put them right in the front of the rib. That'll lay it down real nice. Yeah, throw those little blocks of wood under there, because we're going to let this dry while we're having lunch.
Yeah, I really don't like that little...
Put a little block of wood for right now. Like a carpenter, you want to put the pins in on an angle. They'll get a better grip than if you put them straight up. There you go, what a guy. I'm saying Kajewski would be proud. He'd have a nail gun here. Bonk, bonk. A pin gun. Okay, sight it. Look down. If you need to, adjust it. Okay, adjust the little wood blocks if you have to.
Don't touch the thing.
Now don't do anything. Let it sit here till the epoxy dries. Let's see. perfect.
We
okay.
Got a killer wing coming up here.
We want killer lunch. All right, let that dry. That's the next thing. Just let it dry. Burp, burp, Robin. We had a great lunch. Now, this should all be dry, but before we take the pins out, I want to put the spar joiner in. All right, now we just ran a rough piece just to see how much the angle should be. And that's a little bit too much, so Kenny marked a piece. Just do it on a belt sander. It's easier.
Yeah.
You only need to sand it. You could even do it with a sanding block. And keep in mind, in the kit, this notch would already be cut in here, but we're going to have to relieve this because that's also going to act as the support so that the spar is joined and also that you have a little bit of meat to attach the bell crank to. I don't want the bell crank floating out there in midair. What's he doing? Okay. Yeah, just... I think you only need to just hit that on a belt sander just a little bit. We want to put one on top, one on bottom. Then we can pull this off and put the pin blocks in.
That should be pretty close.
Okay, now you need to mark the ribs and just notch it out. Just the two. Let him show you where to notch it.
We're going to notch, yeah. And then we'll sand this angle in.
Okay.
Perfectly.
Now take a zona saw and just go down the thickness of that spar. You don't want to just glue the spar in the middle. That's not what you want to do. You want to make it that you get rid of the stress riser by doing this. Just, that's good. And then chip the last little bit away. It's easier to do this now. This will hold the wing in place. Even though the glue joints aren't permanent, this will hold it in place while we pull it off the table. Yeah, this way you can fine-tune that angle so you're not putting any stress on it. Just wipe it a couple times.
That's very close.
Oh, that's nice.
Okay, now chop that. Cut this down a little further because this won't drop in. It's a little high.
Just take a little, one ice shaving off of that with the blade. You can just make sure it's nice and flat and run some thin CA on it. CA that right together.
Then
repeat the same thing on the bottom. You got to do the bottom.
Well,
it's a little awkward.
Let's trace this.
Trace it out. What a smart idea.
Oh, lazy Ken here.
Lazy Ken. You know, there's an advantage to be born lazy. Ask me. Okay. While Kenny's working on that, I wanted to show this little thing, even though this will be on our other video. He did a little test with tissue, made up a little box. Put some tissue on it and cut out the letters out of tissue to see how that was going to look. That's going to ultimately be on, I guess, somehow he's going to lay it out on a wing, but that looks pretty good. Not bad, guy. Not bad.
Yeah, I just wanted to see.
Now, the only thing is up here where you have the TV,
yeah.
You should have the outline of a naked woman. Oh, no, a nobler. You should have the outline of a nobler in there. Yeah, that'd be cool. What a side view of a nobler or something.
I just wanted to see. I played with the fonts I had in my computer, and
a side view of a nobler would be cool. That would be a definite. Plus, this will be real light. Let's hope.
This is, by the way, this is tough stuff.
Nice and strong.
Yeah, John says this is Japanese tissue.
Well, it warped actually, this already. So I mean, whatever it put a warp in that already.
Maybe
the whole plane is going to warp up. All right, you got the spar joiner in there? Oh, my God, look at this guy. You're becoming a craftsman, my boy. All right, now putting the bottom one in is going to be a little trickier. But that'll definitely join it, and then we'll pull it up off the table. You're making a bottom one, Ken?
Yeah.
Okay. Do is cut the same roughly sized notch out of the bottom here so he can slide that in from the bottom. Take the new blade. I just put a new blade in this one and take a piece of 1/4 inch square, trace it on there. Bottom one you got?
Yeah.
And Robert's got a perfect little notch. Oh, look at this guy. I'm telling you.
He's turning into a craftsman on it.
Whoa, man. Kajeski sees this, you're gone.
Everyone has to...
Here's where a wing is going to break.
This side's got it. No, you know what it is? This side's got to be cut bigger, I think.
Notch still looks too small.
Okay, so it's got to be made.
Just shave
the pen line on.
Shave it little by little till you get a nice notch. Again, the only reason for doing that is to hold the wing together while we're pulling it up off the board. Okay, with that little piece glued in, now we're ready to clear the table and get this jacked up on the little pin blocks. Again, don't be surprised if John Brodak has little pin blocks molded with his name in them and my face or something soon. That's a great little building accessory. Probably realistically 45 minutes to do this much. Realistically, how long? Less than an hour? 45 minutes?
I'd say 45 minutes.
45 minutes to get this much done. Realistically, laser cutting makes it all possible. All right, let's clean the table. We're ready. Now, the next thing is just to get the pin blocks that we have. Kenny's, we've made these up. These are part of the Nobler video series. All they are is they're run through a table saw so that the height is all the same. And we need to block this up on the table, get a couple of them put in the front so that it's set right on the center, center of the spar, center of the trailing edge. Just run them right along the leading edge, Robert. Make sure they go right into the middle of that wing. And this will get you right in position. As soon as it's in position, we'll tack glue them down with CA. We can put the sheeting on. Go right into the point, that's right. Again, a nice part about this wing jig system is...
it's cheap.
It's free! Boy, I like that, brings a smile even to Robert's face.
Okay,
like that, free. Now see, this could be a little molded part. Kenny had this idea. Was this your idea to make these out of plastic?
I stole, yeah.
And write Brodak right across the front and have the pins molded right in.
Have a little recess for the pins.
Yes.
So you can stick it in.
Oh, man, that's just great.
John, I want 10,000 of them.
Anyway, what this does, this holds the center line of the wing, center of the front, exactly the same height off the whole table. In a matter of minutes, you got the whole wing jigged up. It also lets you turn the wing over in a matter of seconds, reverse the blocks, do the sheeting on the other side. When you get them all centered, one or two drops of glue on each one. Hit it with kicker. Now you could also, if you wanted to, you could get that little gauge over there and check that the whole wing is the same height off the table. But I don't really think you even have to worry about it at this point in time. It's plenty close, believe me. If you have these pins in the center here of the trailing edge and that's in the center of the leading edge, that wing should be exactly the same height off the table. The whole length, width of the wing. In fact, you can look down the holes and see how straight it is. And that word free. Oh, I love that word free.
So it doesn't matter how thick the blocks.
No, these blocks could be
the same size.
As long as they're all the same, right. And the only reason you need these at all is so you can get the sheeting on with this held in a nice straight position.
There's no free lunch, but this comes really close.
This is economical lunch.
Asked me, you know, as we were putting, we've added some extra blocks to the rear wing, he says, well, you know, is it in the center? And the thing that I came up with is, when you put these in, you hold them down to the table and you slide them in, or you put them in on, if you centerline the trailing edge, and then I found if you can go around and just...
Right.
Just tap it, and there's no real movement, but you get that noise.
Right.
That's
the thickness of a piece of paper. That's plenty close. But this really is a bulletproof way to build a wing, Robert. This is just great. Rough job of trimming the sheeting. It's 4-inch sheeting, but obviously out at the tip, we only need this, say 3.5 or 3. So I want to leave 1/8 of an inch extra, Ken.
Okay.
Put a dot out here, put a dot in there, just cut it with a straight edge. what you can do, once you make up one piece, it's an eighth of inch oversize, check that it's okay, that you've got it nailed, and then cut three more. So we'll have them all cut and ready to glue on. Do a dry fit. Make sure it goes all the way to the front of there, all the way to the back here. Okay. How about at your end, Ken?
Okay. But we're just making it here. My one.
Okay, make
extra.
Them an eighth of an inch. Add an eighth of an inch. I'd rather trim it later. It can hang back an eighth of an inch, but you don't want to see the spore. You don't want to have the tissue touching the spore.
This one is just the right size.
Okay, now take that other wood. Now you can look at that wood. Look for the best part of the wood. Lay that wood over here.
Now when I mark the new wood, I'll just cut it and leave the pen line on and it'll be perfect.
All right, let's look at the wood. Get the straightest part of the wood. When you see grain going off, just eliminate that part of the wood.
Or
so you eliminate this part. See where the grain is all coming together? Use this end of the wood.
And if we have to, we'll true the edge before we...
Yeah. Is it true? Decent?
This is real straight.
Okay.
So what do we want to lose?
A piece of wood like this. This is A grain, and see out here it starts turning to B?
Squared it up at the...
Well, we want to use this side of the wood. We want to favor this side. I'd rather have...
And we want to get this angle.
For a leading edge, I want to have A grain. For a trailing edge, if I had C, I'd use all C. But we don't have a piece. Anyway, but definitely A grain on the leading edge if at all possible. All right, you're going to measure these off and cut them?
Yeah, I'm going to measure them off.
All right, you're going to ultimately wind up with four pieces exactly the same.
This piece we have to
equal panels, equal span. Equal opportunity. Okay, you can just put just the slightest little bit. This is only because this really isn't a piece of 4-pound wood. Pin it on. You could run that bead from the inside.
How are you going to get
the hard way?
Come on, Robert. Just run the whole bead. And you could press it down a little bit as you go. Medium, run a whole bead. Now we're gonna glue all these joints once you can get the wing up off the table. Okay, check this out. You got the block, Ken?
Got the block.
Roll it. Roll and pin technology, roll it down. Oh my God, he knows his stuff.
Just hold it there long enough for this to kick.
Robert, aren't you impressed? What do you mean this is how they make Dutchie pretzels? Yeah, just hold it down. Let it kick normally. Don't go blowing some kicker on there. Oh, hooray! Now, double check that you haven't loosened up any of these blocks. Everything's solid. If you did, you want to re-glue them, just tap them. You'll see if they're loose. Okay, now before you glue the other part, we want to make a little, remember the little lip in here?
Yeah.
Get a little piece, make a little lip in there.
Robert, a piece of 16th?
Yeah, 16, anything. Something. This is good enough. So, you want to make that so it's like a tongue and groove joint in there.
Yeah.
It gives you something to glue onto. Slice a little piece off, make a little tongue and groove joint. A little seam in there, just run that seam. Okay, you got both of these done. Once that kicks off, now all you need to do is pull the ones off the front.
We're going to take these out, right, first?
Yeah, you can take the pins out, pull it off the front, and we're going to flip it over and rejig it on the other side of the wing.
Always twist that. Just get it. Come on. Okay.
Now, when do you put the bell crank in?
I'm not going to put a bell crank in. You're going to fly this radio control.
Okay. Now we're taking all these out?
No.
You leave the back one. Just take the ones from the front, and then we'll do the flip. Just cut it like Kenny's doing here. You don't want to break them if you don't have to. Just cut them as neat as you can. That's why I say only put a drop or two of glue. Don't use
a... How much glue did you put?
Those are the ones you did. Yeah, they come loose. There you go.
These are the ones I did. Okay, so it's six.
No problem putting them down. Now wait, get them all in before you glue them down. Get all of them in. Sometimes if you leave the blocks here, you can get almost in some of the holes or all of the holes. Try to get as close to the point as you can. A little splice from the inside. Now what's nice about this type of construction is we can get inside here now when we're all done with the bottom sheeting and get all of these glue seams from the inside. Where a D-tube, it's impossible to do that. And you wind up having to use slow drying glue on everything. On this wing type of construction, we can turn it up and run every seam. What'd you do, just stick your finger?
Yeah.
Get used to it.
See, it's better if you don't stick them in so far, because the points are where...
It's the point that matters.
The points are
the
all
points
squared
are what,
up, right? So let's start over here, and we just need the point in here. That's all you need. That's all you need. See, I'm trying to get one point of each block in the old hole.
To do is get one side wet, just damp. Now see, if you had real 4 to 6 pound wood, which you got to start saving for these projects, this would be optional, but with wood this hard, it's not optional. This is really like 8 pound wood, but it won't be a problem. It just makes it a little more difficult. Well, you put your splice on ahead of time. That's a good idea.
Yeah, that was Robert's idea.
Hey, Robert, cool. Wow, Boeing is looking for people. Joe Adamusco will hire you for this. Okay. Down there already?
He just zoomed right through it.
Boy, he's zooming. Take that up a second. I want to see how that little piece looks. Yeah, that's good. It gives you a little tongue and groove joint. Okay.
We're going to have to get this match up.
Ah, it's a thing of beauty. The old C-tube wing option. Okay. Roll that sucker down there, baby.
That's it. We got that bug now.
There was a bug in there. Look, there's a bug inside his wing. The poor buggy, Robert CA'd the bug to the wood. What a mean guy you are. I thought you were a nice guy.
Hey, that's going to keep my plane flying.
It's a sacrificial bug.
Yeah, wait, that bug has parents. Some bug the size of a van is going to come to your house and kick your ass.
That was a little baby hornet.
It's the cardinal bug.
Oh, man.
The cardinal needs something to eat.
Yeah, call that plane Bugsy.
Bugsy. Do we have any sea grain? No sea grain? If one of those pieces of sheeting Robert brought was sea grain.
This has a little sea grain on one side.
Get the piece that's all sea grain. It'll be worth it. Hey, you could dress that off. We'll sheet the middle of this and flip it over and put the bell crank in. Isn't it nice working on it when it's glued to the table like that?
Yeah.
I mean, when it's in your lap, it's a pain in the neck. This is good. That piece of center sheeting needs to have an angle put in. You can do it by eye, you can cut it. But if you lay out a piece of tape, now since we know we can't fill it in one piece, what's the sense of saving? Now just you can trace that line out, and then when you shove that up, you'll have that angle in one piece. You know what I'm saying? This gives you this angle here. Otherwise you don't have, see, otherwise how would you get that angle? You're going to be sanding with a sanding block all day to get that.
Time to clear the table again.
Yeah, it's time to do a cleanup job. You could use the razor right on that. But that gives you the angle in one stroke of the pen instead of having a... Otherwise, you go back and you go 14 times before you get that angle.
On my other Nobler, I made like 6 of these.
You make 12 of them before you get one that fits.
Exactly.
Yeah, tell me about it. Okay, that should be real close to being a good fit there on the first shot. Now, let's see. Okay, you got a pretty good fit on the first try.
I would think so.
Do we need a pass on the sander or no?
Yeah, you need to take...
A little off here.
Just rub it on a block. And then we want to lay that angle in there. One pass I would go would be all you're going to need. Now see how that ties up. What we're trying to do is lay this out like the cardinal. You want to have that little piece. This little piece of wood avoids a stress riser. Otherwise, where the two things come together, you're always putting stress in the wing right there. This alleviates that. So what we did, we traced out the two ribs. We're making a pattern. Put a dot in the center, and then connect with the two edges, and left just enough room for the cap strips. Now you can cut this out real careful. Leave enough room here. Now we use the whole template, just big enough so when we get in there, all the edges will be the same size as a Dremel sanding drum. Okay, you can cut that out now, and that'll be your pattern then. And then just make two of them.
Could I just use?
Yeah, doesn't matter what you use. You could do it on a Dremel saw. It'll be fine too. But the thing is, now that's your pattern. Mark it, pattern. Always leave the line on when you do a cut like that. And we'll do the final sanding. Hey, when you want to avoid vibration, get your hand up closer to the bit. Hey, you can control it better when your hand is up close. Nice that fits with the stress riser missing and everything. Now, what you want to do is just make sure you have enough wood when we make that piece back there. You do. This will now be your official pattern. Cut two of those out. Out of that piece of sea grain that you have. You got that piece of sea grain?
Yeah, it's right here.
Okay, cut two pieces out of that. You could probably do it on a jigsaw the easiest. Just repeat what you had. You'll line up the bottom. Always make a pen line and leave the line on. And you know you got to make two of them. Now it's real handy if you can make these out of sea grain wood. That really adds a lot of strength to the middle of the wing. Well, Robert's cutting that sheeting. We're trying to get the ends flattened off while it's still hooked to the table. Block sand that all down. You can just go by basically and cut. Notice that we're using sea grain up. This whole wing is made out of 3/32 sea grain. And actually, we're not making this wing out of really, really punk wood. This is really like 8-pound wood. It'll give us a good indication. See how much nicer they are if they're sea grain? You really don't get any twisting or anything.
Now these are wider than I'm used to, but they go with the character of the of the project.
You could thin them out a little bit if you want. Thin them out, it won't really matter. Make it one turn thinner.
Now,
there's plenty of room on there to make. I just want to make sure we radius everything.
The Q-tip. And then
let's push this up against that one so you get a tight joint.
That's tacked. That's tacked.
Okay.
Okay, now you come back and spray this, Robert.
I'm going to do this side the same way.
The piece cut out for the top, so that'll speed us up when we get to the top. Okay, now next thing we got to do, get another piece of scrap. Let's figure out this piece down here with a little radius in it. You want to simulate that same radius.
We'll put more CA in that when we sand it.
Do it while dope is drying, that's all. Okay, while Robert's doing that, we got a couple of the cap strips in. We just stripped off some of the sea grain. We got to get the rest of the cap strips, and then we'll be ready to put the bell crank in, flip it over. You understand the reason for having these radiuses here is otherwise you have a stress riser. Wherever there's a corner, all radius corners. Little tube is good.
Gotta get this line straight.
Yeah, just use a nail file on that one. That's good.
This is only a card.
Get used to sweating the details, my friend.
Yeah.
Keep moving. That's
if you do a haircut, what do you tell a guy? It's only hair at the back of his head, he'll never see it?
Yeah.
Come on, get real. Ooh. All right, President Nixon. They all did come out pretty even. Now just watch you don't catch the end of the block up there. These all rub your finger on it. When you can't feel them, you know you're done. How are you doing? Your cap stripping up this end? Okay, what's happening? See, you're crushing the end of it? This is what's happening. You got to make a nice, neat cut. If you don't, if it doesn't make a neat cut and it's all crushed, you don't get a good glue joint up there. See, here's what's happening. See how the end of this is getting crushed?
Yeah.
You don't get a good joint, like this, see? You need to get a good joint. Well, let's get a brand new double-edged razor out. That's the only way you're going to do it. And we'll put tape on one end of the blade. Two individual ones. All you have to do is get to the point where you can't feel it with your finger. And then you can finish it off with some fine paper or whatever.
I like to get them a little close before I use a big block.
Yeah, good idea. All right, always put tape on one end of the razor. That'll give you a neater cut. If you don't get neat cuts, it's going to be that you'll never get them to stick right. Now put that in there. Mark it just a little bit oversized. Slice it, but don't try to slice through. Now just put a score. Now cut it again. That's it. Now hold that at about a 45-degree angle. Do you know what I mean? If you hold it straight up and down, it does no good. Let me show you something. Hit. If you hold it straight, or if you hold it this way, no good. It's got to be a 45 degree to break that angle. Okay, feel it with your hand. Even a little bit of an angle there is a killer. And as you're doing it, feel each joint. If you feel a bad joint, for instance, if this one up here, if you can feel it, just hit slightly.
I'll get the radiuses in first.
Now get the radiuses in.
And then I'll sand, you know.
Okay, because then we're going to be ready to flip it over soon. Just go right down the whole thing on this side, radius it, and then we're ready to flip it over and put the belt crank in.
Well, we can flip it anytime you want, because I could do this.
Okay, and we're not looking to reuse them, so.
We've already reused them. What do you mean?
That's why Brodak is going to make precision blocks with the pins molded right in. I can see it coming. Come on, John. Okay.
I sent in my patent.
Your patent?
Information last week. So.
Okay, just pull that off. Check it out.
You don't
better leave it
you
for
don't
me.
Want this wing.
Yeah, you better leave it for me, Robert.
You don't want this wing, Robert. You want a foam wing.
Don't worry, Brodak's going to make permanent blocks. Clean the table, boy.
You're
taking up my whole day here, man. I got to charge you by the hour.
That's
look
what
at this.
I mean, you see?
Look at this. If we had permanent blocks, we'd be done at 3:30.
I don't have all day to.
Your time's valuable? Is that what you're telling us?
What you guys.
You got a pad on the table to keep Robert from ginching it. Now just run a bead on each, right? Hold it down while the glue kicks. On each rib, this gives you, locks it right in. It's as straight as an arrow. It's locked in, baby. And lock it right in. And now you don't need any of the pins, the jigs, or anything. You're ready to roll. All right, just take the razor plane. Take a little bit off, hold it on an angle. Start to get the beginning of the radius in there. Flat first and then kind of tip it one way or the other just to get the radius started. Very important not to have the leading edge come to a point. You want to have a nice smooth radius. Yeah, as long as we have the dust getting all over the place, get that straightened out too. That trailing edge roll straightened out, the leading edges. You're evening up that tail, Ken? Okay.
Right.
We're cruising. How's it look, Robert? Let's see. Straight? Oh, yeah. Okay. As soon as you're done there, we'll put the belt crank in. Just let me know when you're done. Always just thread the belt crank. You just thread the belt crank in, leave the wire hanging out, and what we did, we put a tack of glue on it. You don't even have to break ribs on this to do it.
It's
in the center?
It's close.
Okay.
This end of it is a 64th high.
This is high? Okay.
This end of it is 64th high.
It's going to break away from here. It doesn't even matter. A 64th, I'm not going to worry about. There we go. Okay. Now get it level, and then we'll put a drop of glue on it. You tell me when it's level. You get the glue, Robert. You get it level. I'll let Robert just put a drop of glue. We could zero that in, no problem.
Okay, let's...
Right there?
Let's call that level.
Okay, put a drop of glue. That's why we serrate that wire. Put some kicker on it, and make sure you got a full range of motion now. It's not binding. We don't have to cut the ribs open or anything.
Oh, man. This is perfect.
Okay, let me look down from that side. And now we're going to make up a little hardwood brace to go in there. Let's get a little piece of motor mount or something. Right in the middle. Oh my God, you are so lucky. Robert, you are a fortunate soul. All right. We just found out, just a phone call before, that Pat Travers received Joe Adamusco's ZZ Cardinal as a gift for Christmas, proving there is a Santa Claus. Okay.
And he works at both.
Let's make a little piece of, we need a little piece of motor mount wood or hardwood to make a little cap for that. Made these little pieces out of old scrap motor mount, and all they're doing is keeping the bolt from, the only way this is ever going to pull is in at you. It's not going to pull backward or sideways. So we're going to put these little pieces, we'll put this one in the bottom, and then we'll fill that in with some scrap balsa wood. I'll do the same thing on the bottom now. Let's just glue that one in the bottom, and that's just a little piece of motor mount wood, and then check that it's not interfering with anything. There's no interference on anything. Now let's get the center sheeting on here. Okay, lay that out. Now don't forget, you gotta leave a little radius here. So put that under the push rod, do this. Put under the push rod. Okay, now trace out. Leave yourself, push it over this way a little bit more. And put a little dot on here.
A little dot where?
Put a little dot there. Now put a little, you gotta cut this off here. Cut that off first, and then you want to put a dot there. Then connect the dots, and that'll give you that piece of wood. And then
so
the last
just
thing.
Cut this right off.
Cut it right off, yeah. Now that's going to give you that little piece plus that little radius that you want to have in there. Okay, now you got a dot on both sides. All you need to do is get a straight. No, take a ruler. Take a ruler. Take this off now. You got two dots. Where's that ruler we had? Always better to make it a little bit bigger, leave the line on, and then sand a little bit, the last little bit off.
Should we just cut it with a razor?
Cut it with anything you want. All right, President Nixon. Okay, now what we did, we took the circle template again to try to match that radius. Now you can take and just leave that oversized, and then we'll use a Dremel drum to finalize that whole thing. Just pull it right out. Okay, that looks real nice. Now I want to get the parting wheel and just cut that off, just so it's easier to work on. Just leave a 64th of it stick up, and we'll make a little cap for that. What we're going to do, just cut these out with the saw. We'll make two little pieces, and that'll get buried. The body's going to cover, should cover the whole thing. This will be inside and underneath a fillet. All right, just cut it out on a Dremel saw. Now we're closing in on having this guy done. This is definitely a nice way to build a wing. This one is even going faster than I thought it would. All right, now we just got to turn it over and do the same thing on the other side. Hit that with some thin CA, that'll harden it right up. That bell crank's not going out anywhere. Anyway, when the final fillet's there, we'll just blend that right in. You got the other little piece? Okay. Hold the end of a pen or something on it, this way you don't glue your finger to it. Famous last words. Well, I would say that was a good day's work. I'm not unhappy with that at all. Even Santa Claus would give you some credit for that. All right, now the next time we see this, this is going to be all really smoothly sanded out. You got a block to make wingtips with? You need the pattern for the wingtips too, right? Now, in the last couple of days, Rich Peabody had the Spitfire molds. He was molding up some stuff. And what he found out, basically, he confirmed the things that I feel are true, that you could make a nicer, lighter turtle deck by laminating two pieces of wood, or even three thin ones, by laminating them together instead of making one thick piece. And I need to make a molded part today for a customer. And what I want to do is, I'm just going to basically repeat what he's done. What he did, he took two pieces of 16, wet them down, laid them over the mold. We need to put a joint in one of these. Again, once you have the molds, now we get to this time of the year where we're going to be more and more active in building, and it's so nice once the molds are already made. You basically can make one part out of it every day. And I just think every time I do this, I think, now imagine I have this big square block of wood and I have to start carving and hollowing. Instead, by the end, I'm going to wind up with one really nice piece, almost no work at all, an hour. Now, the only thing with this is I can see, if I remember right, the 4-inch wood, we need a seam off to the side, so I want to put maybe an inch piece on here. I want to put the joint always on a molded part, off to the side. Never run the joint right down the middle. And I'll stagger it, so one joint is on one side, one joint is on the other side. And each time I do this, again, when I started this, I even made one with three pieces of 32nd. That was okay, too. But the two pieces of 16 seem to be the best for this kind of a turtle deck. You wind up with an 1/8-inch piece. And I think what I'm going to even try to do is put some fiberglass cloth in between the seam here. Anyway, got a little time to experiment before Kenny gets here to work on a nobler, and I even have those wheel pants to work on. I really want to get this down pat, because this is a part that we hope we're going to use over and over and over again. This is one that we've made probably 15 or 20 out of, and I've done them in various ways, so I know pretty much what the limit I can use is. In other words, I know I can't make this out of 1/16 wood. I know if I make it out of one piece of 1/8, it's really heavier than it has to be. So this gives me another choice, and I think this is going to be the best way of all, is just using two pieces of 1/16. Again, always important to have A-grain wood, most of all. And out of this last batch of wood, we did get quite a few nice pieces of A-grain. You try to make a piece like this out of C-grain, definitely going to be a problem. Now what I do is, I try to figure out which side of this I can kind of steal from Peter to pay Paul here, so I can trim the back piece of this, and use the back piece up in the front. Now, just like making up skins for a foam wing, but I want to stagger the joints. I'd like to stagger them. Always good to do most of the sanding, or all of the sanding, before you even mold a part. Again, it just, it's unbelievable. Every time I see somebody carving a block, I think, oy, 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 oy. Boy, I don't miss it at all. Believe me, there's things I don't miss. Now, I just want to verify before I make the second skin that I've got enough material. I can go wire to wire here. Okay. Now, there's several ways you can do this. Several ways that we've tried already. One of the ways is to mold both of the parts at the same time, one on top of the other. That's one way. Then when they're all, oh, this ammonia really blows your mind. While they're drying, in other words, let them dry, take them off the mold and then laminate them together. Now, we've done it that way already, but we've never done is take the two pieces and using aliphatic resin and some glass cloth laminate them. And that's what today's test is going to be all about. Again, if you don't try every possible combination, you never know that you're not going to find a way that's really terrific. Now, if the only thing we ever did was mold up eighth-inch wood, well, yeah, that'd probably be a lot better than carbon blocks, but this is really hopefully going to give us even one other choice that we've never had before, and that is to have some glass cloth inside of this and to have water-soluble glue instead of epoxy. Aliphatic resin is a lot lighter than epoxy, so I think there might be a gain that we can make an even lighter part, an even stronger part by using this method. And notice I'm just soaking this stuff with epoxy. With a matter of fact, do yourself a favor, put the cap on right away. Woo! Good old common ordinary ammonia. Now you could use Windex. You could mold the two pieces off, one on top of the other, then put them together with epoxy. That's another choice. But again, I cut some glass cloth, and I want to take some aliphatic resin and thin it just a little bit with water and see how that works. Again, if you don't do all these tests and if this doesn't work, hey, I'll just make up a piece of eighth inch, no problem. But this should give me one other choice. Again, once these start to soak, they get pretty flexible. Now again, aliphatic resin is water soluble, so there should be not a problem to get this to dry and spread real nice. And a little bit of ammonia that's still left in the wood may even thin the glue even more. Yeah, that's watery now. I don't want to have so much glue that I'm oozing out. I remember Harold Price used to build his whole plane with aliphatic resin. It was just, it had a little, like a hypodermic needle, it used to squirt in little glue seams. Whoa, just beautiful. Now what I want to try, again, since this is the first time we're trying this, don't really know exactly how this is going to work out. And of course, there's nothing to stop you from putting aliphatic resin, or building a whole plane with aliphatic resin. It's just that you have to wait for the dry time is, but you get spoiled with hot stuff, don't you? Just unbelievable. CA really does spoil you. And again, this would now be a laminate, not only a laminate, but it would have some cloth. I would think that the struct test on this would be unbelievably good. Somebody squeezes your turtle deck or whatever. Or the other thing is then you could sand the outer shell of wood down paper thin, knowing that you've contained this inside. Another thing I've wanted to try, and maybe I'll try it if we get to build a real Spitfire this year. Don't know how the time is going to work out, but one of the things that I really wanted to try is laminating some glass cloth in between the plywood doublers. And aliphatic resin would be a great way to do that, since it's almost, even when you put a little water to thin it, it really makes nice furniture-like joints. You don't get all that glime and glue like you do with epoxy. Okay. Now I want to stagger the joints. I forgot which side I put the joint on. Windy. Okay, that joint is on that side. This joint is on this side. Now it's always best to run a few pins in here. Get it centered. The pins are the trick here to keep this in place while you're wrapping the bandage. And you take them out as the wrap begins. Now as I'm working my way down, I get to this pin. This is the by the way, the bandages that they have the self-stick feature are a lot better than the ones that don't. Just put tension on it all the way. This gets not a little tricky, but doesn't matter where the cloth winds up. That's all going to get trimmed out. Now if when you get down to the end, you see you've left too much wood on, you want to trim it before you get to the next station. I want to keep track of where the wood is coming down. Just perfect. It never works perfect when you're on camera. Another side benefit might be, by doing it this way, might avoid having that split in the back that almost always happens, and then you have to do a little minor repair. The cloth might help that. Now what I'm going to do is put this up by a heating vent. Obviously the heat is on. It's freezing outside. And let this sit there for a day or two before I even take it out of the mold. Dry up all that alphatic resin. And just take the pins out as you go. Now we got no split at all in the back. That's usually where it splits. So this may be, well, I guess we're going to find out tomorrow or the next day. Now usually you wind up, I had to use two bandages on this. Whatever's left over, just go back over the original one. It'll put even more pressure on it. Another trick, of course, is to always sand as much as you can before you even make the mold, and then sand the rest of it on the mold. See, the nice thing about the self-stick bandages, they stick right to each other. Kind of like wrapping a mummy here. And then where I end it, I just run a pin into it. And this gets put aside to dry. You might want to do something like this. And when that comes out of the mold, that should be... Well, we don't know. We'll find out. As you can see, this is right up by a heating vent, and that heat is on under 30 degrees out there now. Now today, I basically want to pick up the work that I want to do on these wheel pants. Get these hollowed out. They've already been carved and sanded. Get them hollowed out. Make the struts. Fit the wheels. And of course make sure we have them tracking right and a decent amount of prop clearance. Now step one, of course, is to split them apart. Try to get a nice cut with a new blade or a razor. Now any wheel pants, it doesn't matter what shape they are, I want to try to hollow these out. Again, you always have the choice, the vertical CG, but it's always, if you don't hollow them out, it almost guarantees that you're gonna want to take them off and hollow them out. So if they're hollow, you can always sneak in a little solder or fill them up with epoxy or something like that. So the first step is I want to go over to the workbench and start to hollow these out with the knife. Well, I like to take as much, only because I don't like to make any more dust in the house than I have to. I take as much as I can out of there with one of those scooper blades. And the rest of it I'll finish off with a Dremel tool with the carbide cutter. This is the old carbide cutter that seems to work the best for hollowing out wheel pants and doing these kind of reverse curves. One thing nice about these cutters, they never wear out. They gum up and get slimed up or whatever, but you can soak them in acetone and most of that will come right off. In fact, I've had this one for, embarrassing that I never buy new ones. Anyway, good tool.
Is always to feel with your finger. You can feel the thick part. Put the crust hashes in. Again, I don't really want to make this paper thin, but I do want to get some of the weight out of here.
I'm trying to figure out here. I'm trying to lay out how I want to have this wheel in here. Now, some of the problems that you can make for yourself, you can put the whole wheel in there, and that's great if you're always flying on a perfectly smooth parking lot. But the reality check of the whole thing is you'd like to have at least, in my opinion, half of the wheel sticking out. And what happens when you go to lay this section out, let's say this is where it's going to be, on a nicely curved wheel pant, the hole works its way up the side, so you really have to make some kind of a concession to it on the bottom. And it gets tricky to do this. It's not impossible, it just gets tricky. But the first thing is I want to make sure I have, because this is going to be a circle burner, flying John Brodak backyard kind of plane, I want to have half of that wheel sticking out, if possible. So I measure that off, run these two pieces together, and just mark them that I can get both of them notched the same. Run over to the work table and get a notch put in there for the wheels. Now a lot of this is just cut and fit, cut and fit. I always use the example of sheetrock work, but, and by the way, we are going to be making molded fiberglass wheel pants in the future, but this ship we won't, because I don't want to hold up the production of it in the time it would take to normally do that. Now I want to scribe a line half the thickness of the wheel, plus maybe a 1/16. You just have to do this by eye. Of course, I want to try to hold the knife 90 degrees if possible. Try to peg this in. And the object is that I can put a little side piece in here that I haven't really figured out exactly how I want to do it. That'll actually hold a wheel. Makes a piece of plywood or hardwood. Okay, now the deal is I want to line this up with this. Make sure my alignment can be a little bit time consuming to get this, but a real nice set of wheel pants are really worth it. In my opinion, it is anyway. Okay, the next thing I want to do is I want to go over to the bench, tack these two together, and then I can even out that opening and see how much more. Now, see, it's a little on the tight side. I'm going to have to take a little bit more. In fact, I ought to take it off ahead of time. Take a little more material off. Scribe a little line on there. Now again, it's best probably just to tack these together rather than put a permanent seam on them. And when we're all done, and run the seam on the inside. Now what's handy here, those good old Bud McKnight sanding sticks, you can cut one just to fit right in there and dress off all the areas. And of course, we want to take a little test fit here, make sure we have some clearance for the wheel. Now, I need to just make a rough layout of the plywood parts that are going to go in here, and I want to make them oversized and then do the final trimming when I'm all done. Now, I know I can use that line. I can trace that up, and I'll still be in solid wood here. Now I need to know roughly how much of that I want to stick out. This is just a rough piece anyway, just a ballpark piece. Trick is here, make it oversized and then trim it down. Or just use the first piece as a pattern. Now I'm trying to figure out, see, I left this oversized. If I'm gonna, I need to make it a little bit longer. That's not gonna be long enough. I need to make the top part just a little bit longer so I can see, I can add a, this is how I really have to do this piece by piece. Just add maybe an eighth of an inch to that and I'll be fine. So I'll make up a new piece. Again, in any kind of pattern making, this is just a back and forth thing here. And I want to leave it oversized. Always leave the incline on, leave it oversized. I want to catch as much of that wood in there as I can. Now I want to make sure I have enough clearance for that wheel in there too. Looks like it's a little tight. I'll have to sand a little bit of this out. Okay, glued that first piece in. Now what I want to try to do is establish how much clearance I have. I want to have the right amount of clearance around the wheel pants too. I wanted to just get a little alignment on this to figure out about where I wanted that to be. Now I want to cut another false side on this side. single most important thing when making wheel pans, make a left and make a right. If you've never done this before, you're going to get all done and make two lefts or two rights, just like fuselage side. So I can see I need to trim this off a little bit. But I want to, at this point in time, make sure, very sure, that I have a left and a right. Well, it's nice to know you got here on time today. Anyway, hey, let's see this. Just for last, what is this now? This is Rudy Rybex?
Right.
Okay, nice double exposure. Ken is learning about double exposed pictures. Anyway, I'm going to get back to getting these wheel pans together. All right, I'm getting ready to glue this side in, and I want to set the clearance. Make up the other sides here and get these fit up for a little dry fit. Again, just looking back and forth and trying to make sure they're equal. It's getting inside with some thin CA to harden up the wood inside and also fuel proof it at the same time while I have this giant piece of wood sticking out here. All right, I got to match up the axle holes now.
I need to get that thumb.
All right, now I want to hopefully just leave these oversized and then grind them in. Of course, the problem here is I want to make some clearance for the wheel. And that's really not going to be exactly how I want. I'm going to take some more material off of this side. Now, I'm thinking I ought to just give that one more swipe with the sandpaper and use the wheel to hold it in alignment while I press that in, while I glue it in. Rough things, but Ken's working on this while I'm grinding away at the wheel pans. Yeah, that looks pretty good.
Yeah, it's a real handy thing to have. I'm really glad I made this. I'm gonna.
Well, it's handy too if you have a hatchback car. You can lay this in a car like Adam Usko does.
Yeah.
I think he had some kind of gizmo holding the back of his car. This is nice too, by the way. When you're working on a plane, you could drill some holes here, put tools or something.
Yeah, I've already got a hole.
Knife, yeah. Yeah, that looks like it's going to be a good deal. Another brilliant idea. Now it's a question of just getting a Dremel tool and just relieving a little, just enough of this material that I have a little clearance for the wheels. This one's tight. This one's pretty close. Is to get the clearance inside finalized, of course. Now, Kenny's out there grinding away on that Nobler, man. I think that's going to be a useful thing for him to have, especially if you don't have a big padded table. That really makes working on a plane nice and easy. And they're still too tight. I'm just going to have to keep grinding away till I get the clearance that I need here. I wanted to fill in some of the wood on both sides, and what I did, I took one piece just to see how I would like it. Put a little piece of scrap in there, and obviously I'll do the other three and then sand it all in. Most important now is to keep the wheel clearance. A lot of times you make nice wheel pans, and after you're all done, they're all full of glue and paint and everything, and the wheels don't turn right. I'll make sure I don't paint myself into that hole. I'm trying to grind this in and make a smooth transition here. It just takes a little time. Invention, just a great, an absolute mind-blowing good invention. This is nice.
Yeah,
would you put contact cement on there?
Just epoxy.
Oh, okay. Contact cement would work well on that too. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, don't leave the pins in. That would have really been smart. Now, what you have to do down here is put return to Ken. You'll never get it back. I never gave Stifle back the one he gave me.
Well, it's a real lifesaver because...
Oh, it's great.
If I want to work in the kitchen on the kitchen table, I throw this up on the table.
I think Adam Usko has a way he puts that right in the back of his car, so I never really look. He's got some kind of foam thing that just fits right in. And if you really want it to be cool, you could make some kind of, I don't know, like a top half of this where it would, you know, even a wind couldn't blow it out when it's on the field. All right.
Well, it's
I have to tell you, I am impressed. That is pro. Even George Aldrich would like that. Professional. Well, listen, what are you anticipating doing? You going to do any sanding in this today? I'll move the other plane. This is ready to sand. I'll tell you what, you need some more clear on this. See, this tissue should be as shiny. I'd put some dope on there. You got enough on there to sand. You got some time today, you may as well do it. Yeah, that's nice. See up here, you can feel where that tissue... I mean, you could hit that real quick and you'd make some big progress right away. But you don't want to put any more on it till you sand this down. And you sure need some more on the tissue. So you can see the shine. You can even see it on the video. You can see where the shine is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You want the tissue to be that shiny before you really sand around the cap strip edges and stuff.
Well, the cap strips are starting to build up, so we're getting somewhere.
No, it's shaping up, no doubt about that. Well, I've been trying to blend these in, putting little wood plugs there and then sand it in. I want to recontour this whole thing. I want to seal the whole inside with thin CA and then get these ready to mount up. Now what I try to do is get four or five coats of CA on these joints because I know around anywhere this plywood begins or ends, there's going to be, this thing is going to take a beating every time you land in the grass or whatever. So wherever this ends, do this, repeat this four or five times. It'll harden up the wood, prepare the surface. Nice little tube or a dowel is good for getting right in these radius corners. Now, if we try to carve this out of balsa wood, you wouldn't have that plywood support in there. That's the problem. You need to somehow bury that support. And yet I want to bury it without making this overly wide either. You sat up and read. I'm trying to figure out how to get these things on straight. Anyway, I want to lay out the spats neck, the gear legs next. Ken's up here
you
grinding
don't
away.
In Playboy magazine?
Not you, that's for sure. I'm just trying to lay out what size I want of a template for this landing gear leg here. I want to make it up out of light ply so it doesn't self-destruct halfway through a season. How's that coming? Good?
Good.
Real good.
I just pushed someone up.
Not this. I want to make sure when we had these on here that they were equal when they were slipped on. Because again, I want to be able to do as much of the work on these off the plane as possible. Okay, I want to double up on this thickness so it'll give a little more support to this while I'm working on it. Again, just light ply, just making these legs out of two laminations of light ply. Try to get as much of the material up on the wheel pant as possible, and I can just grind this off even. Now I did the other one and I wound up with three of these guys. I needed three of them, three laminations, so I'm gonna make the third one up here. And I've been trying to get the angle in here so that I can fill that all in with glue and epoxy, but I need three laminations all together. All right, with all this trimmed off, now I want to lay out where the wire is. Cut the notch for the wire, and that's probably going to be all I can get done tonight. Boy, time flies when you're making wheel pants, doesn't it? Time flies when you're making fillets. Now, with the little router bit, I want to cut that little trough in there for the wire.
See the seam coming through here of the plywood, the laminates of the plywood. I'm even take a little piece of sandpaper on here. I want to get a kind of a nice tight fit around that 8-inch wire.
Anyway, we're going to finish these up tomorrow. Ken's still grinding away here, trying to put dents and holes in an oval.
I'm doing a pretty good job, too.
Get any dents in there yet?
No, I'm pro.
And these will be ready, actually, tomorrow. Make the fillets up on them. I think they're going to start to look nice. Looking forward to finishing this up, and then I can put a little finish on this, and we'll be ready to start building a wing pretty soon. I have some real nice ideas for that wing, some tricky stuff. Now what I'm trying to do is engineer this up in such a way that these will ultimately be removable, of course. See, I need to figure a way of keeping these from rotating. I'm going to have to solder a little tab on the back here, I think. I have to figure out exactly what I want to do here. I want to put a little center line on this and carve to the center line so I get a little bit of an airfoil shape to this. I have three laminates of light ply here, so these should be pretty durable. Every time you say that, you know they're gonna break. Vulnerable, anyway. I carve that in, try to get a nice little airfoil shape in there. I'm telling you, Bud McKnight, I love you. They are so handy. This is just a typical example. And they do a great job of cutting light fly. Now, because you can see the laminates in here, when you start getting down, you almost don't have to feel it. I want to get that airfoil shape in there. But what happens in the front and back is you wind up with a lot of end grain. So what I want to do is harden it up with thin CA. Now, especially where the landing gear is going to go in here, I want that to be good and hard. And I have to come up with, I'll have time to think about this today, some kind of clip system. Something really creative. I'm sure I'll come up with something terrible. I want to harden up all the wood around the edge here too. It's so important to get this wood real hard. And then I want to make a little fillet out of aeropoxy so that can be drying while I'm working on other stuff. It works great on sealing up the end grain. Found out with these that works well. They always seem to wear out on the two ends. If you cut them right in the middle, now you have two that have a really nice edge, and of course you can put points on them or angles or whatever you need, but they're good for getting right down into grooves. So handy, hard to believe. If you've never used these, it really is time-consuming getting all these little angles in here, but I think this is really going to be a real nice little set of wheel pants. Again, there's no substitute for a mold. Oh, would I love to have a mold for these right now. We'll be making a mold real soon. Don't go away. We're going to have our own fiberglass wheel pants real soon. Now, I want to use this as another test for good old aeropoxy. Again, this is a 2-to-1 mix by weight, not by volume. So I want to basically take a little bit of this out. And it really does pay to, obviously don't put that stick back in the other side, pays to do this with a gram scale. So now if I know I'm adding, let's say 3 grams, 2.5, I gotta add 5. So far we've been real lucky with this stuff. I'm amazed how lucky we've been. Now we just want to add or take away until we get to 7.5. Need a little bit more. There you go. One of the few tricks we found with aeropoxy is after you think it's mixed and it seems to mix the brown to white, mix it some more. The couple of times that we've not mixed it really as well as we should have, it seems to take a lot longer to dry. It eventually dries, but then it gets no better than that, you know, epoxylite, where this really is nice stuff when it's mixed right. Again, it just takes a little extra time. Actually, that's true, by the way, of any epoxy material. When you think it's mixed, you really should mix it a little bit more. They tell you on a lot of these high-end epoxies, when you think it's mixed, add another 2 minutes to that time and keep stirring it and whipping it. And when you can't see any streaks of white or brown in this, then it's a good idea to just give it an extra 2 minutes, and we'll do that. Because this again now becomes a what we want to have here is not only the fillet, but we want the strength. Same as when we put the fillet on the fuselage. And we want to use this as a test. A year from now, I want to know if dope's going to stick to this, or is it going to break? Is it going to crack? And unfortunately, the only way you ever really learn about this stuff is you have to really go out and do it. It's just unfortunately no shortcut or short way to grandma's. Okay. Look, right in the middle of putting my fillets on the wheel pants, Karen comes down with her antique clock that needs to be finished. You're standing right in front of the camera, baby.
Excuse me.
Nice cherubs. You get, how would that look with
they
a little wheel pants sticking out?
No, I don't think so. It's cute.
All right, we'll do a little refinish job. What do you want to do, make it gold?
No, I want to wait till we get the wallpaper. But we can we can hang it just as is right now.
Well, you got that other cherub thing in there. Do you think I'm I'm going to be putting off my modeling projects here?
No, I want to hang with this bathroom so we know what time it is.
You're making people feel sorry for me.
And then when we get wallpaper, we'll finish it to match the paper.
I'm supposed to be a professional modeler. I'm supposed to be just doing this 24 hours a day, not have to do cherubs and clocks and stuff.
We really do like to do it.
Anyway, this stuff maneuvers nice with the trowel, and of course, your finger, of course, it works real good too. Yes, my life as a professional modeler, uninterrupted by things. I'm sure everybody out there has got the same exact thing. Now, if in doubt, it's always good to put a little bit less on and then put 2 layers so it's not totally thick. Now, last thing you can do, if you want to save a little bit of sanding, you can take a little bit of isopropyl alcohol and just give it one wipe. You don't want to get too much alcohol in there, just enough to smear it around, get a smooth finish. Just save some, 5 minutes of sanding, like we really care, but. Like to make a little hook on these because I want to hang them up by a heating vent. Anything you do with epoxy, especially if we're going to let this sit overnight, the heat will help cure it right up. Boy, that is nice. Just sitting up there cooking, and we'll pick this up tomorrow. Cook away, baby.
Beautiful day out there. I wish we were out there. Well, maybe Kenny will get over here later today. Be a good day to spray some dope. Anyway, when trying to do two projects like this, it can really get to be, well, you're always trying to prioritize and figure out what's drying. Now, this we let dry for 2 days. And again, when you're unwrapping a mummy here, of course, each one now is like an adventure. This is an experimental one, and we want to see how it came out. Now, I see one thing what happened here that I really have to watch out for is a little bit of glue got through. I'm going to be careful popping this off. Ooh, there's a little bit of glue around the edge. Gotta get a knife. See, I had to cut this around the edge. In fact, I broke a little piece off. But here's the way you learn things. Now, what I can envision happening on the next one, I do like this. I'll put a piece of saran wrap on the mold. There we go. See what had happened? A little bit of glue leaked underneath here, I guess oozed out. So I can just dress this off with a piece of sandpaper. But it would be a good idea in the future and see a little bit caught back here. If you're going to use aliphatic resin and ammonia, maybe that's what you want to do, and that's an important little lesson. Again, I want to keep these molds in real nice shape if possible. Again, see, I didn't think of that with the aliphatic resin and the ammonia. It gets so thin when it's under compression. A little piece of saran wrap would have been fine. Again, I really want to take care of these molds because I anticipate getting a lot more parts out of them, even nobler parts. More little tip I learned about these self-stick bandages. If you just leave them laying in a box or laying on a floor or whatever, they lose their stickiness a lot faster than if you roll them up and put them in a little plastic sandwich bag. I don't know what the deal is, but I think the sandwich bag just keeps the dust off them. And being we use these on a regular basis, it pays to do a little maintenance. And it's all these little tricks and tips that, hey, can just make the modeling part of your life just go just flawlessly. Again, this is one tip I learned. It's just leave it in a little bag. In fact, I could leave these right over by the molds. I have extra little hooks. That'll save you a lot of wear and tear on the bandages, or that you can't find. Believe it or not, I lost these one time. I spent the whole day looking. Couldn't find them. Somebody borrowed them. If they're a nice little bag like that, it's cheap insurance. Before I start trimming this off, I like to run a red line right down the wire crease, and without that wire crease, you're really going to have very little chance of getting this trim to be a perfect fit. Another thing, whenever you're trimming a shell like this, really, go put a new blade in the knife. And that's only because my eyes are so bad, I can't really get a good cut on that. Now it's interesting when you have a little piece of scrap like this to see how much strength that cloth actually does add, quite a bit of strength. What Peabody was calling a destruct test. Well, now this is where having that an old sanding belt glued to the table comes in real handy. Now, the idea is to do as much sanding right on the mold as possible. So I just want to get that edge trued up. In fact, you can see that that edge is pretty decent. Now I can put this right back on the mold and do all the final sanding. Always sanding on the mold, whenever possible. Again, by doing a little test like this, we added to our knowledge base. Try to come up with some alternative ways of molding, alternative ways of building. Things that just make it a lot more fun, more interesting, maybe lighter, maybe better. As long as I'm going to take care of business here, I put a little note on a mold because Peabody's going to be using this again this week. Cover mold with saran wrap or tin foil when laminating. And I dressed this all back off nice and smooth, but that's just another good tip. And these are all the little tips you learn as you go. Unfortunately, you just can't be born knowing this stuff. You got to just beat your head in the wall until you figure it out. Now, the final part ready to install is always, to me, I always put a little frame piece up here. That protects it in shipping. I'm always amazed at how long it would take. If you carved this out of a block, had to buy the block, I just always think this is just such a great thing. It really does make modeling a lot more fun. That's Ken finishes his bagel. Bagel man. Oh, it's starting to look so good. Oh, yes. Now, what's your plan today? You're going to do a lot of sanding?
I'm going to sand as much as I can, some of this clear
off.
Hold
this light here. You can see how much extra he's got on the cap strips and the edges. But we're going to pick this finishing part up on the Nobler series. Just like to drop this in here. How many coats you have on here altogether?
8 or 9.
Okay, fantastic.
8 or 9. 2 shrink.
Yeah, we'll pick that up on the Nobler tapes. Now, I'm always impressed how nice this aeropoxy sands out. And while I got time here before I put any CA or filler or anything on here, I spent a little time just making up a little sanding block out of a half a nail file. But this stuff, if you can see it up close, it really powders off really nice. Do as soon as I get these both sanded out, I want to cover them with a couple of coats of thin CA, sand off the CA. Then I need to make the little brackets here, but then the wood will be nice and hard. It won't tend to take little bumps and dings and little things like that. But this is really now the Nobler that Kenny's working on, and this we've basically been real happy so far. The fillets look real nice. And this material really is super light. This is really one of those best of all world materials. Dries up the next day, especially if you put it up by a heating vent. You can see it powders right off. This is the test that you're doing the right thing. It powders off. No chewing gum. A couple of the reasons for soaking this with thin CA, like I'm doing, a couple of tips. Use up the old CA that you have that's been sitting around. And it doesn't kick off real well, this is a good place to use it up. It hardens the wood, and your noties are going to take a beating at the circle burner field or wherever. It also, then you can get a nice joint between where the hardwood legs come down and the balsa wood and the aeropoxy join. Otherwise, you're going hard to soft, you never get a nice joint. But the trick is, once this is CA'd, go right out over the epoxy. Once this kicks off, never use kicker, of course. Just put some on, do a little spot at a time, wipe it with a paper towel. The lint in the towel will kick it. Then when this is sanded, this will have like a nice hard shell. Also, it replaces the 8 or 10 coats of dope you would need to seal the wood. And you can go right out, probably even today, we can run and put some primer on these. I'm just letting that kick. Even a strut is soaked and wiped with thin CA. As soon as that kicks normally, then I'll be ready to sand it down. Now, always sanding out the first coat of CA, you're almost guaranteed going to go through. When you go through, get a Q-tip, a little CA, and just go back. But once you get that nice, by the way, anytime you see that powder, you know you're in good shape. That nice, velvety, smooth, I don't know how to describe it, finish. You know this is going to take a finish real nice. I'm trying to lay out the thickness of the tabs that I'm going to need. I try to lay them out in tape first. What I probably need to do is just randomly make up four of these. This is just a piece of strip brass, K&S brass. I'm going to deburr all these holes. And one of the things I want to do, just to make this a little neater, this is a piece of scrap motor mount. I want to drill a little hole and countersink it so that I can make a little press. These are the little screws I want to use, but so that I'll have a little countersink dimple in those little tabs, so that this screw head won't be sticking out as far. Just a little detail touch. I drilled that little hole so that the screw would go in and out. This is the end. If you use end grain hardwood, it works real good. Screw fits in there, kind of a slop fit. And I just need to countersink this little top just a little bit. I don't want to drill that hole out. I just want to counter. Let's see if you can see this on the macro lens. What I really wanted to do is just countersink it just a little bit. Now you can put this in a vise. You always want to do this before you actually cut the thing anyway. It just dimples it out. It's going to let that piece sit further down in. Trouble with material this thin, if you did want to countersink it, if this was a little bit thicker material, countersinking would be fine, but when it's this thin, it won't be enough material left, I'm afraid. Do is go get an old pair of scissors, cut these off, and get all the rough spots off of them. All right, tin the back of these. We're going to solder these little tabs on. And you'll notice Kenny and I have this down to a science. Okay, that's tinned. That's tinned.
That means we've already screwed it up once.
Once? All right, that looks decent enough. Always use a good soldering iron. And by the way, Christmas is coming. I could use one. All right, come on. There you go.
Yeah.
President Sauter calling.
Can I take the heat off?
Now, of course, the next step is deflux this, polish it up a little bit. And the wheel pants should, yeah, we should. They better fit right on there.
to make sure I get some baking soda and water on all of these joints. I'll polish them up with a little, one of those 3M pads, and be ready to mount the gear up. Yeah, I just got to trim these off now with the... Yeah, I think we can live with that. Well, we're at the end of the tape. We really did get these working. And I hope you had some fun. Hope you had a few laughs, in fact. We are really enjoying building up this profile. This is one of the... probably one of the most fun projects I've worked on in a long time. The Nobla seems to be coming right along, and we still have plans for an I-beam Spitfire if we don't get caught up in something else first. The wheel pants worked out well, and we're going to probably next week start to work on the wing and try to clean up a lot of little details in the shop. So thanks a lot for joining us, and we'll see you on the next tape.